Are you ready for fantastic art? Yeah. Are you ready for a comic from this guy? Yeah. Are you ready for the most controversial comic the fandom has ever seen? Yeah, wait, what? Then brace yourself for the highly debated and much discussed comic, I Will Survive. I'll be upfront about it. This comic is about the subjects of unwanted pregnancy, abortion, and the rights of the father and the mother regarding those topics. It isn't pleasant. It isn't sweet or funny, and it does not have a happy ending. If you don't want to see any of those things in your Zootopia comics, turn back now. That said, major props to Borba, not only for deciding to tackle such a hot-button topic, but for deciding to stick to it, even after getting a lot of hate for it. That's artistic integrity for you. You have a story to tell, and you see it through to the end. I definitely look forward to whatever comes next for you, Borba.
In the world of Zootopia, humans never happen, which makes Zootopia a modern, civilized world that is entirely animal. Animals in Zootopia are anthropomorphic. But the truth is, Zootopia isn't perfect, and just like our world, not everyone gets along, especially natural enemies.
This was a post made to the website Zootopia News Network, a decently popular fan site dedicated to the Academy Award-winning 2016 Walt Disney Animation film Zootopia, directed by Brian Howard and Rich Moore. Within Zootopia's cutesy, funny animal aesthetic is a broader message about racism and the war on drugs, but that's not what we are discussing here today. We are instead looking into the Zootopia fandom. Obvious to anyone with a passing knowledge of the movie, the Zootopia fandom is largely an offshoot of the larger furry fandom. Circling back to Zootopia News Network, this fan site primarily deals in fan-created content, as outside of a briefly mentioned Disney Plus show, nothing official of note has really happened since Zootopia's release in 2016. So they chose to use their platform to boost other creators. The website frequently posts a large variety of fan fiction and fan comics. It was this focus on fan-created content that would lead Andy Lagopas, the founder of Zootopia News Network, to post an article on November 12, 2016, featuring a webcomic by DeviantArt user Borba. Thanks to Borba for the original comic. I have no idea how, but the Zootopia fandom seems to be blessed with a plethora of absolutely phenomenal comic artists. The action, the emotion, the intensity of the scene that plays out, all of it absolutely magnificent. The comic, entitled The Night Howler's Effect, focuses on the ship between Zootopia's main protagonists, Judy Hopps and Nick Wilde. When Judy returns home from work, Nick pranks her by fake biting her on the neck. Judy then poorly pretends to play dead, causing Nick to freak out and profess his love. Judy then reveals her deception and holds her carrot-shaped recorder pen, revealing she had recorded the entire interaction. The comic was met with a warm reception within the comments of the website itself, likely leading Andy to want to feature more work by Borba. This could be considered a prequel comic to what comes next. 7 months after Andy Lagopas would return with another article featuring another of Borba's comics entitled I Will Survive. While I Will Survive is its official title, it is now more commonly known as the Zootopia Abortion Comic. While The Night Howler's Effect has 18 comments total, I Will Survive has 376 comments.
Come on, let's go. Sweet cheese! Nick. Nick. Nick! Come on, wake up!
We're off duty today.
Nick, I have something important to say.
Just text me, please.
Nicholas, I am serious.
Jeez, when you call me Nicholas, it means I'm in great danger.
You bet.
May I take a shower and do other things before you ruin the rest of my day?
Yes, it'd be best, I think.
Well, what is this important thing you want me to know?
Nick, I'm pregnant.
Nice try, Fluff. You almost got me. As if it were even possible. Your nose is twitching, so this means carrots. Are you sure? Is this for real?
Yes, it is.
Judy! Oh, Judy! This is the happiest day of my life! sorry. I didn't hurt you, did I?
No, Nick, you didn't. But this isn't the problem.
Problem? Oh, you mean because we're, like, from different species, and you think our baby might have some problem, right?
Nick, I don't want this child.
No! I can't believe you said that!
Let me explain, Nick.
So explain yourself. Why don't you want our baby?
There's no baby yet. I'm just in my first month of pregnancy.
And you decided, on your own, that this is going to be the last month, ain't it?
Nick, let's talk about this like adults, right? Right?
Okay. Tell your tale.
Thanks. Well, at first I believed you couldn't get me pregnant.
I still don't understand why you...
Because I'm afraid.
Afraid of what?
Well, in part I fear our child might be, you know, some kind of freak.
So, what you're saying is, hey, Nick, even if you can get me pregnant, I don't want to have any children with you. Did I hit the mark, Judy?
Nick, I should have had this talk with you earlier, and I'm really sorry for not doing so. I had no idea how hard it is for me to have to tell you these things, but I must say that there is a good reason. My career.
That's it. Your career. I should have known you were going to throw it in my face, but you surprised me, Judy.
You don't have the right to say that to me. You know who I am. You know what I am. You know what's at stake for me when we first met. And you knew full well that did everything for my career.
Yes, I do know. It seems you could even kill our baby for your career.
Nick! Nick, forgive me. I lost my temper. Nick?
For God's sake, Judy, give this unborn child the opportunity to do the same. I beg you, please, let your light continue to shine through him or her.
No, as I said before, it's useless. Sorry, Nick, but I've made up my mind. My body, my rules.
I see. Any chance you might change your mind?
No, Nick.
Neither will I.
Nick, don't go away. Please stay with me. Let's talk about this.
It better for you. For us, if you had kept me in the dark about your premeditated sin, goodbye.
Nick, where are you going?
Don't worry, I'll survive.
Nick, if you walk out the door, you don't come back anymore. Nick! Nick! Oh no, no, no!
Nothing lasts forever. Even an apparently everlasting love that has triumphed over the odds and many challenges may eventually come to an end. If poop could crap and crap could shit, this would be it. I'm not moved, and the characters are forced into roles, saying things they wouldn't say. When you write with characters so fleshed out, going against the grain of the persona in such a drastic way makes it purely unconvincing. Wow, now I believe that women should have the right to choose, but that hit me in the feels. Especially, because I was one of the nudie shippers. Nick plus Judy, nudie, so don't yell at me. I feel like the message would have been real and legitimate if they hadn't been dumbasses and used fucking animals. That's just nasty. Find this sad? You would need an IQ of, at most, the numbers of pages this comic has.
Why weren't you at elf practice?
Han Solo dies. Actually, Praxis, not having to bleed to death from giving birth to a baby that's too big for her, is worth losing an a-hole BF who will judge her and call her a sinner for it. If the cost is having to say goodbye to someone who completely ignores your concerns and thinks you're a bad slash selfish person for not wanting your kid, and he thinks he can dictate what you do with your own body, then the cost is acceptable. Anyways, can we just go back to these two being just friends instead of turning them into a stupid romantic drama? Why do they even need to be romantically involved? Why can't two people of the opposite gender just be friends for once? Bad comic OP. Zootopia has a fandom? Huh. I guess anything goes on the internet. Why couldn't the fan base of this movie stick to furry porn? Why has God left us? It's a good comic. You just don't have enough knowledge to determine it. If a mother can opt out of parenthood, why can't a man? The comic was originally posted on Borba's DeviantArt before being uploaded to the Zootopia News Network. It had garnered some notoriety beforehand, even having a YouTube adaptation. The true height of I Will Survive's infamy was yet to come. Before its true discovery, it had already garnered some controversy. A Reddit post from when it had yet to be finished was filled with mostly support for Borba, and most commenters found the backlash to be unfair. Of course, that would not last. Know Your Meme attributes its mainstream discovery to a tweet by Gavia Baker Whitelaw on December 6, 2017, posting out-of-context panels and urging people to remix the comic with different dialogue, replacing the anti-abortion histrionics. Though its discovery was attributed to Gavia, Gavia was beaten by a little over an hour by another Twitter user called Eric Munn. Not long after these tweets, people began to follow through on Gavia's request.
I still don't want the baby.
Oh, Judy, I will always love and support any decision that you make. I would never just pee stored in the balls. Party rockers in the house tonight.
I'm terrified of what the original image might be.
That comment made me realize how lucky some people can be. Going your whole life ignorant of the Zootopia abortion comic.
Omae wa mou shindeiru. Nani?
Why weren't you at elf practice?
One particular edit went as far as to reinvent the entire comic, not as a debate about abortion, but instead frames it as a debate over Nick Wilde's obsession with the fast food chain Arby's.
Nick, the Arby's down the street closed yesterday.
Nice try, Fluff. You almost got me. I just got a deep club from there a few days ago.
I don't even like Arby's, Nick.
You always said how much you liked the curly fries, the milkshakes, hell, even the potato cakes you told me you loved them. I guess it was all a lie.
I liked them before you brought it home 4 days a week, before you started offering to take me on picnics only bringing Arby's. I told my mother how often you bring me home curly fries, and she'd started crying. I had to listen to my own mother cry on the phone.
Well, I'd cry if I found out I created something with as poor of taste as you.
We can eat at other places. We can start buying groceries. It's not normal to eat this much Arby's. You're a medical anomaly. You need to stop trying to challenge God.
Judy? What would have happened if your mother, while pregnant with you, had eaten McDonald's? What would have happened if your mother, while pregnant with you... Shit, no, I still can't do it.
That doesn't make any sense.
Neither has anything you've said. Nothing you make could be as mouth-watering as anything Arby's has given me. Goodbye, Judy.
Nick, where are you going?
To be honest, I'm thinking Arby's.
This explosion in popularity caused online news outlets to take notice. Randall Colburn of the AV Club describes the situation as such. As the world burns, so does our innocence. It isn't hard for casual internet users to find bizarre perversions of entertainment that was created for children, whether it be through a creepily fetishistic Frozen blog or any number of bootleg Disney video games. But there's another side of culture or fandom, one wherein an anti-abortion advocate feels a Zootopia fan comic is the best vessel for sharing their views. According to an article by New York Mag written by Brian Feldman, this attention even caused Zootopia abortion comic to trend on Twitter for a while. The memes grew and grew, spreading from Twitter to Tumblr to Reddit, eventually leading to the creation of a TV Tropes page. Even with this immense popularity, it all leaves one unanswered question. What type of person writes Zootopia abortion comics? William Borba is a Brazilian comic artist who posts primarily on DeviantArt. Borba was not very keen on the criticism lobbied at him during the fallout. He generally eschewed his DeviantArt comic section for his initial story, even though he's actually rather active in his other comment sections. While TV Tropes isn't always a reliable source, as it lacks the basic need for sourcing claims, it can give us a general idea about how people felt about his actions during this. Listed in the trivia tab under Trolling Creator. Given the subject matter, Borba received considerable negative feedback for this comic. As with most heated internet discussion, a majority was rude, aggressive, and uncalled for which unfortunately showed off the negative side of the Zootopia fandom. However, Borba seems to take a certain delight in trolling the conflict he created, and has shown particular reluctance to openly discuss any reasonable critical analysis of the story. In the aftermath of the comic's release, a pattern emerged. Comments that were favorable of the work generally received a thank you comic from Borba, often praising the commenter for their open-mindedness. However, comments that contained critical feedback were either completely ignored or summarily dismissed as being from haters lacking imagination. even posts made by established Zootopia fanfiction writers, and artists offering reasonable feedback on the weaknesses of his story or his characterization of Nick and Judy. Even in the fallout, few people actually thought of contacting him for an interview, except for an author for the website The Niche Blog, who uses the simple name of Peyton. But I'm grown up now, and I've witnessed and participated in a great deal of weird internet. At this point, I thought nothing could faze me. I was wrong. By the time it popped up on my radar, it had already been memed to death and derided as a current-day chick track. But I was, and still am, fascinated by it. Although it was being circulated as pro-life, it hardly seemed like your typical one-sided church propaganda. For one thing, Judy Hopps' rationale for wanting an abortion is laid out with atypical clarity and complexity. Nick Wilde's opposition seems facile by comparison. And the art. All 24 pages of it was professional standard. It must have taken months. Peyton would reach out to Borba for an interview, and the two would have a brief correspondence over email. Borba claimed it was based on Brazilian clashes between conservative Christians and proposed abortion laws, while also saying most people simply did not get the message he was trying to get across. Instead of his common perception as pro-life propaganda, he says it was meant to be about a relationship falling apart because both parties refused to find common ground. The revelation of the main plot takes place in the text of the final page, making it very clear, in my opinion, that the abortion issue was only the trigger that triggered the crisis. By the way, I have tried to be as free as possible in presenting the arguments of both parties, leaving the reader to take a position based on his own feelings and opinions. Anyway, I want to make it clear that I firmly believe that only women have the last word on what they can or cannot do with their own bodies. When asked why he thought Zootopia was an appropriate way to express this, he said it was because he was a fan, and also, as a counterpoint to what I found to be an excessive number of kissy-kissy fanfictions and fan arts about Nick and Judy's relationship. With that in mind, I created a story that purposely moves the reader out of their comfort zone. He then goes on to say he exaggerated most of it to increase the controversy. Then he says he was only shocked by the excessive amount of hates he received and how quickly it arrived on porn sites. Sometime during the interview, Tumblr investigators discovered some previous work of Borba's that they took issue with. The first was a link to a now-deleted post. Apparently that Borba guy who did the abortion Zootopia comic depicted Sappho as a rapist. I desperately wish this was the worst thing he's created. First, there's the general sexualization of female suffering. Most of his works are centered around Amazon women, by the way. This is an example of that. Image depicts three women naked and bound being led to their deaths. They are noticeably paler than their killers. Yes, I'm gonna be nitpicking. Next is a white woman being grabbed and raped and tortured by tribal men. It doesn't say who they are, just enemy warriors, whose skin is much deeper. Warning for violence and rape. Next, more white women being murdered and raped by indigenous men and a Spaniard. Huge, huge, huge warning on this one! Since front and center in this image is a graphic full frontal depiction of a naked child being held by her hair, it says in the description that she is going to be raped and held as a child bride. There is also a beheaded woman and her decapitated head. This one is a depiction of a girl, listed as 12 years old, and then scratched out to be 13, wearing only a thong and a pinup pose. All of these are clearly sexualized, and the rest of this gallery is more of the same. This is a lot worse than some fucking pro-life comic. His response to the reaction these posts got was this. We live in a time where people feel offended by almost everything. A time when someone who has a different opinion from that held by the mainstream takes the risk of being crucified socially, especially through what we here in Brazil call slacktivism. Using internet and social networks to practice these attacks from the comfort of their homes and most often under the shield of pseudonyms. Well, I exposed myself to their gunfire. I created and published this story using my own name and taking the risk of suffering the ill treatment I now receive from those who cannot stand the existence of opinions different from theirs. As for your question about people who saw something to offend them in my gallery about a mythical and ancient kingdom of Amazons in today's central Brazil, I must say that these people interpreted the drawings in a way totally out of context. One of the main sources of offended comments is a post where I linked two of the various drawings I made in the 1990s as visual aids when I was writing a series of books about the mythical kingdom. Based on various legends and texts written over the centuries here in Brazil about these supposed Amazons. In these two drawings in particular, I show violent mistreatment received by two Amazon warriors who fell in love with each other, contradicting the law and religion of their class, which was based on what would have been ordered by the chaste goddess Artemis. In these books I wrote, this religion provided severe and violent punishments to those who were against the greater principle of chastity. This class of warriors in my books would be some kind of warrior nuns, and only they had that kind of behavior. The other classes of Amazons did not prohibit or encourage a homosexual love relationship, just accepting it naturally when it happened. The two warriors that appear in the drawings were shown positively in the books and in the graphic novel, having been friends of one of the main characters, who already felt revolted with the Spartan conditions of life of the warrior class. The condemnation of her two friends just for the fact that they loved each other was sufficient for this character to begin a rebellion, which completely changes the course of history of the Amazon kingdom in the series of books I wrote. Now they are calling me intolerant, religious, and homophobic, which is a curious thing for an atheist who came from a family with Jewish origins, who has a Catholic wife and has friends from different backgrounds, races, religions, and sexual choices. That is where the interview ends, but it has three comments, only one of which is a note. Just to make it clear that as a Brazilian, every time he tries to excuse something with a "I'm Brazilian" writing about Brazilian stuff, it's bullshit. The drawings are still homophobic. About the comic, I just have no words. Eventually the drama died down and Borba continued with his own art. It seemed he wanted to put the past behind him and move on. Then in September of 2018, he came back with a sequel called Born to Be Alive. Apparently he was inspired by all the support he had gotten for I Will Survive. Creating this sequel wasn't an easy decision, as I explained in the last entry in my DeviantArt journal. I Will Survive created a fuss surrounding the issue of abortion and a great deal of shitposting in the common areas. I said it was a fuss because the comic was about a breakup and what caused it, with abortion theme working just as a contentious matter that triggered the intense argument between Nick and Judy. Anyways, I hope the moods are calmer now, and that this sequel won't be considered as controversial as I Will Survive was. Born to Be Alive also has a TV Tropes page. Borba said at the start of the story that this was going to follow the
Kishio Tenketsu
narrative style commonly used in Chinese and Japanese folktales, which calls for an introduction, development, twist, conclusion, story structure. This style does not follow Western conventions of storytelling, and it can be quite frustrating to Western readers. It is a slower paced story based upon characters' actions and reactions with no clear goal and doesn't require a clear resolution at the conclusion. The sequel follows Nick Wilde returning to the apartment after Judy has had her abortion. She lets him in and, wait a second, Nick begs Judy for forgiveness, talks about how his life has gotten worse since I Will Survive. Judy in turn gets mad at Nick for walking out on her as she asked him to do, and guilts him for the pain she went through after he left, calling him a shameful coward. Nick still asks for forgiveness and grabs her arm too hard, then finds out that she's in a relationship with a female vixen named Shannon. Apparently Judy was the first bunny in the history of Zootopia to get an abortion. Complications with the abortion sent Judy to the hospital, where she met Shannon. Things intensify and Nick snaps, demanding Judy dump Shannon. When Shannon intervenes, Nick shoves her, and Judy forces Nick to leave her life. Again, Born to Be Alive concluded in 2019, however, he was not finished with the overall story. In 2020, he returned with a midquel called The Longest Night, that is just as long as the second part, and the third chapter called Never Say Goodbye, that is said to be the longest one yet, and is still ongoing. Borba seems aware of his status. He describes I Will Survive as infamous, and he also created his own edit of his comic. Outside of Never Say Goodbye, William Borba has also been working on translations of his pre-existing comics, alongside other original and Zootopia-themed comics that aren't abortion-related. Oh, and if you're wondering about the more naughty content, he's not stopped. More accurately, he never stopped. Borba is a showcase of how the internet reacts to controversy. When faced with a controversial and absurd comic, they instead chose to meme it to death, and make it impossible for anyone to take it seriously again. By crushing coal, we got a diamond.